So, how do you say this time? Well, I had a debate that got sparked between my 4-year-old and my 6-year-old about how to say times like that one. I'm Christina Tonneville, the Recovering Traditionalist, and I hope you will stick around as we're going to take a look at teaching kids to tell time digitally in our quest to build our math minds so that we can build the math minds of our students. Now, I really didn't notice that this would be tricky, but it wasn't until my 4-year-old said how he thought about reading a digital clock that I noticed that's different than how we actually say it. And my 6-year-old and my 4-year-old were having this debate in the car one day. And so then when I was cooking dinner one night, I saw the time. And so I asked them to kind of, and I didn't ask them to recreate it, but I asked them each how they thought about that time and how they said it. So I want you to hear it straight from them. Let's hear how the 4-year-old says the time versus the 6-year-old.
What is it? No, can't. I want Riggins to tell me first.
8:06.
8:06? Cam, come here. How do you say that time?
8:06.
8:06?
I'm right.
So you say 8:06.
Uh-huh.
You say?
8:07.
Oh, now it's 8:07. Who's right?
Me.
And yes, I was cooking at 8:00 at night. This was after a long day of baseball, softball, getting kids showered. Normally that's their bedtime, but on this night we were cooking dinner. Now the crazy part is that we didn't even realize that was an issue. And in the car when that happened, my husband was like, I never even thought of that. Why do we say, oh, whatever, when we're talking about time? And for our young kids, it's no wonder it's really tricky because they are trying to make sense of all of these different ways that they are seeing numbers and letters, and they're seeing them in all these different ways and trying to make sense of when it means this and when it means this. And then when we tell them to read time in a certain way, and now we're intermixing letters and numbers together, and we're saying 8:06, not 8:06, but that symbol is really a zero. So it's no wonder that this becomes a little bit of a complicated issue for our young kids. And I'm not saying that we shouldn't say oh, but it's just we need to acknowledge that fact that that might be a tricky spot for our students. Now, one of the things that I really wanted to get at in this video is not just that tricky part, but really what are the big things around digital time? Because digital time seems so easy. All you gotta do is just read the numbers, right? They pretty much just need to learn that in front of the little dots, the colon there, is the hours, behind the colon is the minutes. So we just teach them to read those digits pretty much. But telling time digitally is so much more than just being able to read those digits. So here's my big things that I really want to encourage you to be building as you're getting kids to read and say time digitally. Now, one of the weird parts as kids start working with time is that the switch happens at different amounts than they're used to. So as young kids are starting to learn about numbers, they start recognizing that things switch at tens. So like when they're learning to count, right, you'll hear kids all the time say things like 27, 28, 29, 20, 10. But at 20, 10, it flips over to the next group of 10 and we flip to 30, right? Well, this same thing happens in time, but it's not at tens anymore. Or even hundreds. Now the flip happens at 60. We don't say when we're looking at time, right? If it's 8:59, the next number, the next time is not 8:60, it flips to the next hour, and that's weird for kids. They have not had anything that's been basically, it's a base 60, right? It flips at 60. But the super hard part is it's not just 60. That's for your minutes, but then the hours flip at 12. So after you get 12, the next hour is not 13, the next hour is 1. And it doesn't even flip back to 0, it flips to 1. So it's so weird, right? And of course, if you're doing military time, yes, it does go to 13 and 14. That's a helpful part about military time, I gotta tell ya. But if we're not using military time, we have to acknowledge and help kids understand what's happening and acknowledge that that's gonna be a tricky spot for our kids. Getting that flip over at the minutes and understanding that, and the flip at the hours, is a really important piece to help your kids understand and kind of balance that understanding of it flipping at 60 and 12, and yet other numbers, we flip at 10, okay? So I want you to be paying special attention to that and acknowledging that that's gonna be a tricky spot for your students. Another big important piece when you're working with digital time is to help kids with estimation and understanding that those benchmark amounts. The hour is a benchmark amount. The half hour is a benchmark amount. And so getting kids to understand when it's close to one of those benchmarks. So for an example, my kids go to bed at 8 o'clock at night. And it's so funny, when it's like 7:50 and they're like, okay guys, it's bedtime. And they'll look at the clock and say, no, it's not 8 o'clock, it's 7:50. And I'm like, it's close enough. We're headed for bed, right? They think, no, it's gotta be right at 8 o'clock. Plus they're just wanting to stay up later. I get that. But all of those times where you're like, it's almost like in our minds, we think it's almost this time. Are kids understanding that? Do they understand how those numbers relate to those benchmarks, right? When you look at a number, a time, we want them to understand that's almost this, or it's closer to this. So one of the things that I do consistently is kind of always round a little bit. Like when we're close to one of those hours, I will tell kids it's 6 o'clock, and they'll look at it and they'll be, Mom, it's 5:55. Like, well, that's almost 6 o'clock. And then for my older kids, I would even throw in something like, how much longer until it is 6 o'clock, just to have those informal conversations and let the younger kids be hearing about their thinking process as they move forward. Another huge piece is helping kids understand the length of time. So even as adults, okay, we don't help kids out with this. So I'm guilty of this all the time. Having four kids, I'm always saying things like, just a sec, just a sec, just a sec, I'll get to that, just a sec, just a minute. But that second ends up being like 5 minutes. So when I'm saying just a sec, I want kids to understand that length of time. And so if I'm using that term, we overuse it. I know I am so guilty of overusing it and then taking 5 minutes to get to what I said that I would do. So their judgment of length of time is not accurate. Even when we say, I'll do it in a minute, that minute turns into 10 minutes. So kids being able to judge the length of a time is really, really difficult. So to help them with that, pull out the phones, get those digital stopwatches going, and have them do something for a second. Have them do something for a minute project it up and show them the time ticking away and let them see what it feels like, what it looks like when a minute passes, when a second passes, so that they start to be able to understand those lengths of time. Now, the last thing I want to talk about around digital time is helping kids understand the difference between AM and PM. All right, now this is the weird part is that our times repeat, right? And helping kids understand that there are 2 4 o'clocks. And it's hard for a lot of kids because they never see the 4 o'clock in the morning, but they're awake and being able to see the times in the afternoon. So we need them to understand that there is a PM, an afternoon 4 o'clock, and there's an AM, which is before the noon, that it for all of our times, and helping them know the difference between those two When they're telling digital time, that's another important piece. So I hope that this has given you some ideas for teaching kids to tell time digitally in our quest to build our math minds so that we can build the math minds of our students. Have a great day.